Hello and welcome to C++ Weekly. I'm your host, Jason Turner. In this episode, I'm going to tell you how to avoid problems with ABI breakage, and it's a shockingly simple concept. Now, be sure to check out the video description for links to my ebooks, printed books, Patreon, and GitHub sponsor page, as well as news about upcoming events that you might be interested in. Let's say we've got Lepticus's namespace, and I have this struct. It's very important. It's core to how my library works. It contains some integer and a few characters. And then I also have a function. Okay, so I'm calling this function calculate things, and I'm passing some data to it. Now, I strongly recommend that you go back and watch my video to save C++, We Must Break ABI, or read this blog article to save C, We Must Save ABI from the pasture, where John Heed argues about potential C solutions to ABI breakage in the C standard and covers all of these details about ABI breakage, how and when things can break, which these are a little bit more C-centric because C doesn't have name mangling and function overloads like C++ does, but we can get ourselves into the same situation. So let's say at some point I'm looking at this code and realize I really need to change the order of these arguments for better data packing, better, cheaper initialization of objects. Like it just makes sense to do this. This is a classic ABI break. I have fundamentally broken my code. I have people who have compiled with the previous version of Lepticus's library, and people who have compiled with the new version of it, and party A tries to pass data to party B, and the layout of the data structure's wrong, undefined behavior. Terrible things ensue. The layout's going to be wrong, the size of the thing's going to be wrong, it's going to be bad. So what do I do? What do I do about this? How do I get myself into a situation where I can change the ABI safely? And the C++ standard actually directly gives us a solution to this problem. C++ 11 added this feature called inline namespace. If I were to type this. Now I have created this inline namespace called version 2 underscore O underscore O. And we can see here that when this function gets called, the compiler actually generates a completely different linker symbol. This is going to be Lepticus colon colon version 200 colon colon data. So, if at some point in the future I say I have to break ABI again, I'm going to change this to version 3, then if I've got two different libraries or two different tools that are compiling with two different versions of my library, they simply can't link together. Best case scenario, they'll get a compile time error. Worst case scenario, they'll get a runtime link error. But in no case scenario do they get the undefined behavior that happens when we have a silent ABI break. So that's it. It's that simple. That's what inline namespace was created for. I don't see a lot of people using it. In fact, I hadn't given it much consideration myself until I thought about making the episode that you are currently watching. It does have one major downside. We have to do something here. We have to be aware of the situations where we have broken ABI and now we need to put in a different namespace. And just to take a step back, in case you didn't actually notice this, the point of the inline namespace is that it never actually shows up in the source code. I can call lefticus colon colon data, and that works exactly as expected. But the symbol generated is this versioned symbol. If I really want to, I can explicitly name it. I also, if I really want to, can actually maintain multiple versions of this. So if I wanted for some reason to maintain two different versions of this in the same file, then I can do that. Now, if you may have noticed, overload resolution actually saved me. If I explicitly say version 3 here, then I'm going to get the version 3 calculate things, and that's exactly what I wanted to happen. If I remove the version 3 here from this variable declaration, then it doesn't know which one I mean. So you might do something like this: remove inline from the old versions, keep inline on the new versions, maintain multiple ABIs if you really want to. But this is a tool built into the standard to save us from these problems. And hopefully this is a tool that you can use if you are concerned about maintaining long-term ABI compatibility in libraries that you ship, and at least just let your customers know when they have tried to do something bad. So thanks for watching this episode of C++ Weekly. I hope it was useful. Be sure to subscribe.